What'd you guys think of that? Well, the guy, hey, for those of you who don't play basketball, what you just saw right there is something special. And this is right here is the guy that did that stuff. If you don't know this gentleman, this is our speaker today. He's going to share a story with you. This is Coach AJ Moye. He is our high school basketball coach, boys basketball coach. And he's got a story to tell. But I just wanted you guys to see that video of a guy that's went out and performed on the big stage. And he's a guy that gets it done. And he's got a great story. And we're going to kind of walk through that story today if you guys don't mind. You guys cool with that? Yeah. All right, here we go. So, Coach, thanks for being here this morning. Kristen, thanks for leading us in some awesome worship. That was great. You guys can clap. So you are our head boys basketball coach, and you got a story to tell. And so we'd love for you to just kind of tell us to start off a little bit about yourself. Where are you from? And your. We got this other mic working. It's on. Go ahead.
It's on now.
Yeah, you got it. Tell us kind of where are you from? Where are your beginning? Where are your roots?
All right. I grew up a little bit strange. I was born out here in California. And then my parents, they had a divorce. So then I moved to Georgia with my mom. And I grew up in Georgia. And I grew up in St. Louis. And I grew up in Illinois. And I grew up kind of everywhere. But then I went to high school in Georgia.
High school in Georgia. Tell us a little bit about your high school career.
Well, yeah, high school was good. I think to even go back, I have to tell you, I was probably like 5 years old. I remember my mother.
5 years old in high school?
No.
This is I couldn't resist. I'm just messing with you.
Yeah, I remember my mother. She was going through something, and she was kind of struggling with her faith. And I don't know why. I loved going to church, but I used to go to the church every day. Every day I went to church. And I remember our pastor, Reverend Calloway, still one of my best friends to this day. He even put a basketball goal up at church for me. And then I remember I joined the church at 6 years old, and I used to go home every night. And I used to just pray over my mother. And then she said, one morning she woke up and miraculously she was healed. But I don't remember any of it, but she says that was me, and that was always me. So I went to Westlake High School in Atlanta, Georgia, and that was a lot of fun. While I was there, I was able to become a high school All-American. I did that two times, and one thing I'm super proud of, I was a salutatorian in high school, so I had 4.58, you know, and then... And then also I was a scholar athlete of the year in Georgia as well. And I was the basketball player of the year. So that was pretty cool. And then also I was able to start reading programs at elementary schools there when I was in 11th grade. And they still go on to this day. So I'm really excited about that too as well.
Wow, so you were kind of a baller in high school.
Yeah, all right.
Kind of a baller, right? Tell what kind of, you know, it seems that everything is going well. You know, you're raised up in the church. You had an influence on your own parents. You're in high school, being an All-American and being a scholar. I mean, you got to have offers coming your way. Tell us a little bit about that.
Man, yeah, it was a bit weird. I kind of got tired of it. My mother said, get your own line, because they call like all day nonstop. And so I had to get my own line. But I remember USC, they would send me a letter, and it'd be a letter for each word. So I open one and say, we want you to blah, blah, blah. And it'd be like 130 letters every day from USC. And it's like everyone was calling, everyone was writing. So my mother still has all of the stuff to this day. It's probably like enough to fill up this whole stage. I don't understand why it was all of that. Wow. But yeah, Bobby Knight and Indiana University is where I chose. And I don't know why I liked him, because, you know, his language and the things that he did, you know, he was a little bit out of his mind. But
So you became a Hoosier.
Yeah, but the thing I liked about him, he was honest. You know, everyone else was like, all right, we're going to give you the ball and we'll let you do this and we'll let you do that. And I'm like, well, you never played like that before. And then Bobby Knight just came and said, hey, I like you. You can play, but you're going to have to work hard to get whatever you want. And I said, okay.
For those of you who don't know, Bobby Knight is a legend coach in the basketball world. And our coach here got to play for him. And that's exciting. So that clip that you saw was actually Coach here playing at Indiana, playing for the Hoosiers. And, you know, like I said earlier, that play that he made right there, that's a big deal in basketball. That guy was taller than you, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah.
Well, how tall are you?
I'm 6'3".
How tall was that guy? 6'9"?
6'6", something like that.
That would be me like trying to dunk over this guy.
Yeah.
Right? Not going to happen, right? Right? Big plays.
Yeah.
So you got a basketball career going. You play, you got, you know, you're a scholar. You do well in high school. You end up moving on to the college level. Mm-hmm. You do well at the college level. Tell us a little bit about your accolades and the things that you were able to do in college.
Well, yeah, in college, it was a lot of fun. I won the second most games all time at Indiana University. I think it was like 118 or something like that. And then I also played in the most games ever at Indiana University. And we went to a Final Four. We went to the national championship game. I won a Big Ten championship. I was all Big Ten my senior year. So, yeah, it was pretty cool. And then also to see the coolest thing, I'm weird, but the coolest thing was the fact that the reading program I started in high school, I got to take to 18 different schools up in Indiana, and I started that. And that was real, I had a lot of fun doing that.
Wow, yeah. I didn't know that. Thanks for sharing that. So you used your abilities as an athlete to extend that to other people, your influence, you extend it to other people.
Yes, sir. I always believe that, like in my heart, and I remember like in John and throughout the Gospels when Jesus was speaking and he said, you know, we're to love God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our minds, and to love one another, you know, as we would love ourselves. And that's just something that just rang with me true. And I love every one of you guys. I know I don't know all of you guys. I probably know about 40% of you, but it's like, I want to see all of you, you know, reach whatever dreams that you have. And that's just me.
That's great. So you go through college, you do some big things in college. What happens next? What kind of opportunities are coming your way?
Yeah,
by being a big time basketball player.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. It's like the NBA. I was hit and miss. You know, I got on with the Pistons. I got released. I got on with the Pacers. I got released. Got on Celtics. Got released. Got on with the Rockets. Got released. You know, so and then I went overseas, and that was real cool because I got to play. I played in Germany, I played in Finland, I played in Iceland, I played in France, I played in Portugal, I played in, you know, Turkey. It's like, so I got to see like the whole world. I'm probably like on my third or fourth passport. And so that's pretty cool. But yeah, just playing basketball, having fun.
So you're in Germany. What is this, about 2007?
Mm-hmm.
About 2007, he's in Germany, he's playing professional basketball. And
That was actually 2010. Yeah.
To be corrected.
Yeah.
2010, so not so far away.
Yeah.
Not in the...
It's only 2 years.
Yeah, only a few years ago. Yeah. He's at practice one day, playing professional basketball. And some of his videos I've seen, he's an aggressive guy out there on the court.
Yeah.
And somebody comes down and you take an elbow off the head, off the side of the head, right?
Yeah.
Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, this is the thing that makes me mad. It's like, it wasn't even in the play. Like, we had a real clumsy guy on our team. His name's Dominic, and he was from Brazil. And he could really shoot the basketball, but he was just clumsy. So. It was after a play, the ball had went in, and I was just getting the ball, and I was going to throw it back up. to the top so we can run the play again. And he just comes through tripping. He just runs and he just trips through the lane. And then he falls backwards right into me. So while I'm turning around, I get elbowed right in the temple. And I'm thinking that I was out maybe 15 seconds. They tell me I was out 15 minutes, but they tell me this probably a couple months later. Let's get to the story though. So I get hit in the head and I'm out for maybe 15 minutes, which again, I thought I was out 15 seconds. But I got back up, I practiced, I played, and I remember I went home and I couldn't talk. I didn't talk, I couldn't say anything. I just, for some reason, I couldn't talk. And I remember that night, because I lived on top of a mall, which was pretty cool. I played for the Deutsche Bank Skyliners and they're in Frankfurt, Germany. And so, you know, we're a Nike team and, you know, we're pretty good and we, you know, get this. So I lived on top of the mall, which was pretty cool, man. I had a nice apartment. But it's probably November or October. Yeah, it's not November 15th. And I remember it wasn't that cold, but I put a coat on. And I put the hood on and I zipped it up and you could only see like this. and I was like that. And I was just walking around and one of my teammates saw me. He said, "Yo, AJ, are you all right?" And I did something like this and I just kept walking. And then I went home that night and man, I'm gonna tell you this, and this is how I know God, you know, is real. God loves me. I had a dream that night that what was going to happen to me happened to me. Now, I didn't know what happened, but I woke up, I couldn't move, I couldn't talk, and I remember I just limped out of my house, and I went downstairs to the garage, I waited by, you know, the door, and I just waited till a teammate came, and he gave me a ride, and then I woke up, and then I tried to move, I couldn't move. I tried to see, I couldn't see. And I was like, man, you know what I mean? And then it was a struggle. It took me about 20 minutes to get from here to probably where those stairs are. And it was such a struggle. And I got downstairs and I walked outside with no jacket on, no shoes, because I couldn't see, I couldn't really do anything. And I walked downstairs in my car and I was just leaning on my car, probably about to pass out. And one of my teammates came, he took me to practice. So I get to the gym, mind you, I walked in barefoot.
I'm glad I wasn't naked.
Yeah, it was nothing, I hope. But I walk in, and the thing about me is I'm so, you know, about basketball. I tried to go out there and put some shoes on and go out there and play. And then I get out there on the court, and I pass out. And 4 days later, I wake up in a hospital. You know, I just remember at certain times, I remember I passed out and I thought it was over. I thought I was just, you know, and I prayed to God and I said, "God, you know, thank you for this life that you've allowed me to live and let your will be done, not my will be done." And I blacked out. And I remember I woke up at times and there was blood everywhere. And I saw it, and I passed back out. And I woke up again probably a day later. I saw the blood and passed back out. But yeah, so I wake up and the doctor comes and he tells me this. I don't know what he's saying. And the sad thing is my mother and my daughter, they came to see me overseas and I didn't know them. I didn't know anybody. I didn't even know what people were. You know, you could have came. I'd have been like, you know, and go away, you know. But yeah, I had a stroke and it was because I was born with a hole in my heart that I never knew I had. And yeah.
So you're playing professional basketball in a freak accident at practice one day, put you in the hospital, you end up having a stroke and find out you have a heart condition. What was it like coming out of that, man? Well, I mean, how long were you down and?
Oh, well, hey, that was, people say, well, that had to be the hardest moment of your life, but I don't think it was hard. I think what it was the realest moment of my life. And that's like, I always knew I was blessed and I always knew that God had plans for me, and I always knew, you know, that God was real, and God certainly is. But throughout that whole ordeal, it took me maybe 2 or 3 months just to be able to walk again. I didn't start talking to probably like in month 4, you know, like talking, making rational sense. And I mean, God just had a hold on me. The thing is, I couldn't remember any words in English. I remember I used to have to go to this lady, and she used to hold up flashcards. I remember she's holding up pictures of a bike and a duck, and I was like, you know, just looking. Wow. And but the thing that was nuts, I could remember almost all the Bible.
Really?
I didn't know how to, you know, tie my shoes or chew a piece of gum, but I could tell you, you know, things that David said, you know. Mm. And it was just really surreal. And I'm very, you know, I gotta praise God, you know, that he allowed me to go through it.
What I think is great about your story is that, you know, oftentimes, and you guys think about this, we have chapel speakers that come in, and even my own self, I got a story of living life without God, and then having something happen, and then coming to the Lord, and those are always exciting stories. But what I think is unique about your story is that you already lived with the Lord. You knew him, you walked with him, everything in your life is going good. You continue to be faithful to the reading of the scripture, and one day a freak accident changes your life radically. And I was thinking about this last night as we were gonna do this and talk, and what is it, what's the message that we really wanna send to the students? And what do you think it is that makes a guy like yourself, or a guy like Paul, right? The Apostle Paul, right? A guy like that goes through all kinds of crazy stuff. You went through some crazy stuff and still continue to walk with the Lord. Whereas some people run away from him or really could care less about knowing the Creator. I mean, what do you think kept you so close to him during this time?
Well, I think it's like, I think like Proverbs 18:21, and it says, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it, you know, will eat the fruit thereof. So the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat the fruit thereof. And it's something that I read. I used to read that all the time as a small child. And I just held it in my heart. And the thing that I always knew was in this world, in this life that we live, I think basically you have two types of people. Mm. You know, I don't deal with gray areas, but you have leaners and you have uplifters. Now, what I mean by that is like, you have people and places and things that, you know, you can go around them and, you know, it's always a story about this, always sad about this, or always this and about that. And by the time, you know, you're around them, you're like, hey, and then you're like this. By the time they're done, and then you got uplifters, and those are the people and the places and things that are just thriving with God's energy. And they come around you, you start to feel, wow, like I can do anything, because in actuality you can, you know. That's what God created us for. And I just feel like what you have to do is you have to be wise, and you have to be discerning, and you have to truly allow those things that uplift you to take you to higher heights, and you kind of just got to step to the side and allow those the leaners to kind of fall off your back, and then you can, you know, you can be somebody to them and help them. Mm-hmm. But I think you can't spend your time between both of them. You know what I mean? I think if you're gonna be one who truly loves God, then you have to be about God's work.
Mm. I want to share something with you guys, and I'd like you to close out speaking to this passage right here. So in the book of 2 Corinthians, you guys, Paul is before his people, and he's given a defense of his ministry. He's talking about why we should listen to Paul. Why should we listen to this guy about his life experience? Like, why should we listen to Coach Moye about his story? So as we conclude, I want to read this to you. He says, the Apostle Paul says in chapter 11, verse 16, he says, I repeat, let no one take me for a fool. But if you do, then receive me just as you would a fool, so that I may do a little boasting. He goes on to say that what anyone else dares to boast about, I also dare to boast about. He goes on, he says, five times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false brothers. Paul been through some stuff. Coach, you've been through some stuff. And what I find amazing about the people of the Bible and about you and your story is that people go through stuff. And you got two choices. You can either run away from God, but you still got stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And you just try to figure it out on your own. Or you go through some stuff and you walk with God and invite Him to carry you. What's the difference between those two lives?
Man, you said it all when you said it, but the difference is, it's like when you try to do it on your own, it can't be done. It just can't be done. It won't be done. And the sense of fulfillment, the sense of joy, the sense of peace, the sense of love is kind of taken away. When you do it with God, you do it for God. The sense of joy, the sense of peace, the sense of, you know, love that comes from giving, that comes from sharing, that comes from just being in His Spirit. It's something that words can't quantify, you know?
Mm. Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to close up here, but you guys, when people come and speak to you, they want to share their life with you, and they want to share their experiences with you so that you can begin to wrestle with the things that they've done before you. So you guys can make decisions right now today about how you're going to handle the stuff when it comes at you. Because whether you've decided to walk with Jesus or not, you're going to have to deal with life. Some of you have already had those experiences. See, my story, you guys have heard some of my story where I didn't know the Lord. I got kicked off a bridge. Those of you that know it. And then I've been walking with the Lord. You got a man here who had been walking with the Lord. He knew Jesus. Had everything going for him. Had every reason not to follow Jesus. But in a time of need where a freak accident happens, there he is. And he carried him through it. Did you ever think you'd be sitting in a middle school telling your story?
Nah.
Me either, man.
Never.
I thought I was going to be a pro baseball player.
But like, I'm just so grateful and just so thankful that I am here. And it's like, every day, I probably send out a message to probably about 800 something people on my phone. So if any of you guys would like to get a message every morning, just give me your number and I'll do it. But I just love God, man. Amen. I just love Him.
Well, we thank Him for saving you, man. And here's what we're gonna do, guys. We're gonna do something a little different this morning in our prayer. I'm gonna pray for Coach, and then after I pray, I'm gonna give it over to Mrs. Meyer. But this is a little different. And if you'd like to, in a gesture of care and thankfulness, as I pray for Coach, if you just want to take your hand and raise it up towards Coach as a way of extending your prayer to him too and blessing him, then you by all means do it. You don't have to. But it's just a way of us coming together in community to pray for a man that has been influential in many of our lives. He's part of our campus here. And we appreciate what the Lord's done in his life and that he has a story to tell us, encourage us by. You guys cool with that? All right, let's pray. Father God, I am so grateful that you saved this man's life. That you walked alongside him, you walked with him, you carried him, you gave him an amazing experience as a young man to play the game of basketball and express his humanness, express the gifts and talents of sport. But Father God, on that day, when he needed you most, you were there with him. And we thank you for that because you brought him here to Oaks Christian. And I know that this man is influencing many young men and young women on our campus. He loves you. He pours into these boys that he coaches. We thank you for his story and that you're continuing to write it. I thank you, Lord, for the story that you're writing in each one of these students that sits here before you today listening to this. Each one of them has a unique life that you've given them. And I pray that they never forget that you are the one that gave it to them and that they would honor you with it. So thank you for this time. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this man's life. Thank you for what you're doing in all of us. And as these eighth graders get ready to move over across the campus, bless them and help them prepare them for that transition in life, as well as the seventh and sixth graders as they move up. And thank you for allowing us to do what we do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
True story. I get a text every morning of scriptures from AJ. And I know his basketball team does too. As I sat and got to know him this year and we prayed together, I knew I wanted you guys to hear his story. But one thing you didn't hear that I want to share with you is in a conversation that we were having, he said he wouldn't have changed anything. I mean, this is a guy that is playing pro ball around the world. And he's saying he wouldn't have changed anything, that he's a better person. And just with the greatest humility, he said, I am such a better person. It made me better. And that's a testimony. That's only the Lord can do that. And so take the time when you see him on campus, get to know him and hear what he has to tell you. Amazing, amazing man of God that is influencing our young men on this campus in profound ways. Let's go to the Lord, close up, and I'm going to release you. And I do, as you guys head across the bridge, eighth graders, we're gonna miss you. We're so proud of you. Watched you grow up. Remember when you were sixth graders? Like, you were that small when you came in. Remember how small that was? And look at how much you've grown, sixth graders. But you'll be this big one day, heading over the bridge. True. We do want to encourage you and say our desire is that God would bless your experience over at the high school. That you would be grown and shaped into young women and men that have character and honor, that can stand in a world that's going to throw you some stuff and not let it knock you down. Father God, thank you so much for loving us. Thank you that in the stuff of life, Lord Jesus, that you promise never to leave or forsake us. Teach us, Jesus, how to find you when we can't seem to find you. Give us eyes to see. Bless these students. Lord, I pray safety over these eighth graders, and I pray that you would just infuse their minds to remember all the material they learned this year as they get ready to take their finals. I pray that they would have safety on their trip to the East Coast. Lord Jesus, I pray for the seventh graders that are stepping up into eighth grade, that they would lead our school with honor and integrity and kindness, and that that's the tone they would set. And Father God, as these sixth graders move up into a position of influence on our campus, that they would do the same, that they would lead. Lord Jesus, bless these students. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.